Madam Vice President, welcome. We are so honored to have you back in New Hampshire and on a beautiful if brisk day. You missed the snow from yesterday. And we're also really excited to have you here to talk about an issue that is so critically important to Granite Staters as it is to people all over the country. But as you know, as we all know, and I think you've met Steve Camarino and Jeff Berg and Phil Terrell, but as we all know, broadband access and affordability is not a luxury, it's really a necessity. And we learned that even more during the pandemic, when the need for reliable broadband, high-speed broadband access grew significantly. And so it's a really important issue to all of us. Unfortunately, all through the Granite State, people don't have the kind of access to high-speed and reliable internet infrastructure, or even if they do, some of them can't afford it. And one of the stories I bear in mind is a little town named Gilmanton, not very far from where you landed this morning. One of the teachers there told me this fall that her students had to drive to the school parking lot in order to get the connection. So that's not acceptable, and that's why it's so critically important that we're working to bring broadband everywhere and make sure it's affordable. And so we've made some progress. As I think you all know, the CARES Act provided significant funding. New Hampshire got $1.25 billion in state aid that was fairly unrestricted and flexible, so they could use that money to begin the process of getting that infrastructure out to where it belongs and making sure people could afford it. Then we had the end of the year funding and relief package, and that had about $7 billion in it for infrastructure, particularly focusing on things like telehealth, broadband mapping. One of the issues we've had here is that the maps that say who's got access aren't accurate, and so that bill had money for accurate broadband mapping as well as access for low-income families. Then we passed the American Rescue Plan, and one of the provisions that I really worked hard on in that plan was $7 billion for the E-rate program. And for those of you who don't know what E-rate is, that's a program that allows our schools to buy the kind of Wi-Fi hotspots or additional technology modems, routers, and devices for internet access for students so that our students would have better access to broadband at this critical time when they're doing so much remote learning. And now before us, we have the American Jobs Plan, which really has a goal to make sure that we are getting that high-speed, reliable infrastructure to every household in the country, no matter what people earn, no matter where they live. The goal, the purpose, is 100% connectivity all across the country, which will help not only our families and small businesses, but it will also really create jobs and help boost our economy in such a critical way. So we are really working so hard. You're going to hear from Steve, I think, next about what the co-op has been doing as it's moved into this role of broadband provision. But we are just really, really grateful to you, Madam Vice President, to President Biden, to all of our colleagues on this focus of getting broadband all across the country. You are in Plymouth, and this is called the Gateway to the White Mountains. And as you look up north, you can think about what a difference this high-speed, reliable access would make to people throughout the state. People could be living and working in these beautiful areas and really bringing the kind of economic vitality that we need so much in all parts of our state and our country. So thank you, Madam Vice President, again.
Thank you.
I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Senator. And Madam Vice President, thank you so much for coming and joining us here today on behalf of our more than 200 employees at New Hampshire Electric Cooperative and our board of directors. I really, really appreciate it. Coming out on a beautiful spring New Hampshire day. So welcome. And I wanted to tell you a little bit about our story at the co-op and how it relates to broadband. So back in the 1930s, I'm sure you know, it was clear that a lot of rural and agricultural America was losing out and not having economic opportunity because of the lack of access to electric service. And under President Roosevelt, a program was started that supported the formation of consumer-owned nonprofit cooperatives to fill that void. And federal support was absolutely critical in making that happen, and those became sustainable businesses that were serving areas where the investor-owned utilities really found that The distances were too great and the profits were too small to justify their going. And that model has worked extremely well here in New Hampshire and elsewhere. But today, with regard to broadband, we find ourselves in a similar circumstance. There are areas where the density is too low for investor-owned companies to go. And so the communities there are really losing out in terms of how we educate, how we do healthcare, how we conduct business, how we communicate, and they are going to fall behind. And that concerns us because those are the communities that we live in, and it concerns us because if those communities don't remain vitalized, that will threaten organizations like ours that are providing electric service. And so we felt, especially with COVID-19, the urgency of stepping in was greatly increased. And so last year, our board decided that we should step in and start to build out broadband infrastructure in our service territory. I should add that having broadband throughout our service territory actually will help us further our strategic plan as an electric cooperative, because it will help with grid modernization and support widespread adoption of distributed energy resources, which is part of our vision for the future. But we really can't do that alone. Just like back in the 30s, we need some federal support so that we can be sure that we can get this off the ground and not have electric consumers bearing the financial risk. We've proven that we can do that over the long term. We have taken some of the money that was available through the state and federal government back at the end of last year, and we built systems in Leominster down in the southwestern part of the state, as well as in Colebrook, which is in the far north, and a couple of surrounding towns. And those systems are up and operating now, serving about 1,000 locations. So we feel that we can bring that to the 118 communities that we serve across New Hampshire, but we need your help. We really appreciate the support you've provided so far, and you're coming here and focusing attention on this issue. So thank you so much for coming today. And I'm going to turn it over now, I think, to Jeff Bird, who's one of our line design techs and has been working on some of the broadband projects.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Jeff. As you know, I'm a line design technician here for the company. I answered to the engineering division part of the co-op, and last fall we were tasked with incorporating high fibers. Excuse me, I'm just really nervous.
We need to know what you know, so you just tell us, because yeah, we don't know what you know. You're teaching right now.
So we were tasked with subcontractors to get high fiber on our current infrastructure at a small town called Leominster. That had very, very little broadband, and in our rural area. So we walked. I'm sorry. excuse me.
This is what you need to know. So all these guys, they may or may not understand what you do, but they need to understand what you do, because what you do is so important.
Thank you.
You are building up our country.
I appreciate
you hear
it.
Me? I'm serious.
Yes. Thank
You're
you
building
very much.
Up our country.
I appreciate it.
So teach them what you know, because
okay.
They don't know it, and they need to
I'm
understand
I'm just
going to
go right off the trail.
There you go.
I
all right?
Nice
all right.
Well, last fall, I was tasked with assisting our subcontractors, Tilson Incorporated, with building what we call a backbone for our infrastructure. Specifically, we're attaching fiber to our existing utility poles, and there's currently an increasing demand for the high-speed internet in our rural areas. This is mostly due to demand relative to the past year, where we did most of our work and education from home. So to date, we were able to bring high-bandwidth fiber optic cable to 403 members in the town of Leominster, and currently we have 146 members that are actively using our. So we're pretty happy with that. We're off to a really, really good start. So we also now, as a result of this, we have several new positions that we've hired here at NHEC, and we're expecting we will be hiring even more to fill in those positions as the broadband starts to move along. Part of my responsibility last fall was I walked along some of these secondary roads, these small dirt roads, and we had to measure utility poles to see if we had the clearance for our new fiber wire, which was going through there. So I had the opportunity to speak to several of our members, and everybody to a person was extremely happy with the fact that we were going to be having high-speed broadband, because they just don't have it out there. I think some of them actually still have dial-up.
Mm-hmm.
I think
right.
So You know, in Leominster, the town that I work in and I design in is actually the home of the very first pole that we had as a co-op that we set in 1939. And in fact, several times a week as I work out there, I'll drive by, the existing pole is still there. So it's pretty amazing that pole one is still there. And I often will stop and think and reflect about the people who put that pole there in 1939 and what they would be thinking today, you know, with the technology and everything that we're doing with this initiative. So thank you very much.
Oh, that's great.
Now I'd like to turn it over to Selectman Phil Turrell.
Thank you. I'm a selectman in the town of Leominster. I'm currently serving as a chair for that board. The pole that was mentioned, I lived on that street for 25 years or so. I drove by that pole too. We're very fortunate. I knew the family that worked hard with the co-op to originally get power to our community, and we appreciate that. And now as a selectman, I was kind of the liaison when the co-op came to Leominster and said, hey, we want to do broadband. Well, that was a huge boon for us because our kids were doing distance learning at that time, and many of them couldn't really get on and work at the same time their parents were trying to work from home. There just wasn't the bandwidth. And a lot of that changed as the fiber came in and they started to do the installations to our homes. About 40% of our homes now are broadband. And that's really an awesome number for something that I think we put the first installation in December 14th. Wow. And they've really pushed hard to get that done for us. And it's been great. We have people that live in town that are retired and part of their family's working from home. Well, the retired part can't watch TV while the other person's trying to do their job because they don't have the bandwidth. That's changing. That's all changing for the better, and we love that. We appreciate that. We appreciate the co-op for all they're doing for us. I have a gentleman who works in our community, has an office there, does an awful lot of business in New York City and in Washington, D.C. He's done work at the White House. He's a restorer. He restores furniture. Takes down your wallpaper, saves it, puts up new. Takes thousands and thousands of images in Washington, puts them up to the cloud, gets home and spends days, literally days, trying to download those images so that he can do his job. He was looking at 158 kilobits to be able to do that with. Now he's got a gig and he can literally do it in minutes. It makes a huge difference in a community where people want to live a rural lifestyle, but they want to do their work from home. And so this is a great thing about this project and what this means for a small town like Leominster. So we can't say thank you enough. And thank you for coming here and supporting us.
Thank you. Well, let me first thank all of you because I am here for a number of reasons, starting with my friend and former colleague, Maggie Hassan. She and I were elected to the United States Senate the same year, so we were part of the same class. And I'm going to tell you something about, I think you know all that I could tell you about Maggie Hassan, but I'm going to say it anyway. I've seen her in rooms where there are cameras. I've seen her in rooms where there are no cameras, and she is always fighting for New Hampshire. She has been one of the strongest voices in the United States Senate about the need to implement broadband for everyone with an emphasis on rural America. She is one of the leaders and the reasons why in the bills that she has mentioned heretofore we have had the kind of resources put into broadband, again with a focus on rural America. So in front of all the friends, I want to thank you, Maggie, for the leadership that you've been providing. And it was also on her recommendation that I came here today because you're doing incredible work. So to your point, in 1936, the Congress passed the Rural Electrification Act. And the idea was pretty basic. Not everybody in America had electricity. And it was really clear that without electricity, you couldn't function, you couldn't participate at an equal level, you couldn't be competitive. The quality of life would be so compromised. And so we said as a country, hey, no, this is everybody in it together. We all have to participate in making sure everyone has the basic services that are necessary to raise their families, participate in society, and be productive and economically strong. And then in 1939, that pole was built and it's still there. And why we're here today is because what you have been doing in this co-op is building on that legacy. I love that you drive by there and see it. It's literally a symbol of the fact that we have a legacy of doing this work in America. We have a legacy of saying we're going to have a commitment, a national commitment, to making sure everyone has access to the basic things they need. And now, in this year of our Lord 2021, that's broadband. So we're literally building off of what happened out of that recognition in 1936 around electricity. We're literally building off of that to make sure everyone in America has access to broadband. And I think that you are absolutely right. This pandemic really pointed out, you know, you've been doing this work before with this co-op. And you've been doing the work because we knew it was important. The pandemic pointed out it's a necessity. Our kids can't be educated without broadband. You know, many of us grew up with, you know, if we had to do our homework and need some help, we could look at Encyclopedia Britannica. Well, those days are over. Now you got to have access to the internet. We knew that before the pandemic, and it became an absolute necessity during the pandemic. You look at it in terms of running a small business. If you want to be able to advertise what you're doing, if you want to be able to move your product and have people make requests for your product, you have to be able to have access to broadband. And it has to be affordable, Maggie Hassan, like you always say, access and affordability. Let's think about our seniors. Again, the pandemic made so clear. Some of our most vulnerable, those who need health care the most, couldn't get to the doctor. But we have this thing called telemedicine, where you could get diagnosed, where you could get treatment, if you had access to high-speed internet and broadband. So we're talking about essential work, and the American Jobs Plan will put $100 billion into getting access to broadband and affordable access to broadband for everyone. And it's the same thing that our country decided to do in 1936, saying let's get electricity to everybody, and rural America should not be left out of that priority. And part of the American Jobs Plan is also not only $100 billion getting broadband to everyone, but with an emphasis on co-ops, with an emphasis on the nonprofits, with the emphasis on the ones that are being led by the community. And so that's why we're here today, to just see it, and to understand that this really is an incredible moment in our history, not unlike what our country did in the 1930s with electricity. We can do now with broadband. So let's get it done. And thank you all for your leadership and all that you're doing. And again, Maggie Hassan, thank you. You really are not only a leader of the great Granite State, you are a national leader on this and so many other issues. So
I appreciate it so much, and you guys are great partners. You know, the administration has just been on the phone literally with a lot of us, just saying, what do we need? How do we make this work? We've got a lot of work to do to take the American Rescue Plan and roll it out, but to get the American Jobs Plan over the finish line too, because this is all about opportunity and getting people back to work, and watching as the pandemic ends and we're seeing light at the end of the tunnel, really just watching how we can rebuild even better.
And leapfrog,
yeah.
Right? Like leapfrog into it. Let's get in there like you guys did around the pandemic. I think I read 100 miles in 100 days you did? Is that right?
That is right. In about 3 months, we got the whole thing built.
Yeah, that's phenomenal. And so you need the support.
Absolutely.
You need the support. What you're doing here on the ground, literally. You need the support. You deserve the support from our federal government.
Well, and part of it, if I can say, is that our nonprofit status is part of keeping it affordable. Because we don't need the same kind of profit margin.
And
we have a very member-focused view that really is long-term infrastructure serving our members.
That's right. Well, thank you all.
Thank you.
I'm so glad that you all are doing this work and that we could bring attention to it as a model for our country of what can be done and what's possible and the talent that we have on the ground to get it done. So thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So what are we looking at here?
These are transformers.
Okay.
And these are service transformers that go outside of members' homes to take down the voltage. They go throughout our electric system.
And these wires.
This is actually the fiber optic cable right here.
Yeah.
There it is.
Yeah.
Looks a lot like the electric cable, but this is fiber optics. And that's what's been going in Leominster and Colebrook and hopefully in 118 other towns eventually.
That's great. This is wonderful.
So it's quite an operation. And that's what we do. We build and maintain infrastructure and do it to serve people.
And it requires great skill.
It takes a lot of training
and the work that goes into doing this.
Well, especially a job like what Jeff has. There's a lot of training and schooling that goes into getting the job. But then I think Jeff would tell you there's a pretty steep learning curve even once you're in the job.
Yeah.
Because they're the ones who are just designing all of the drops for homes, both for electric and for the broadband side and some of the system expansion. So it's kind of an engineering function, if you will.
Jeff, what was your training? What did you do to lead up to this?
4-year apprenticeship, ma'am.
Yeah.
So you started off working with somebody, you're riding around with them and they teach you everything, and there's 4 different levels of classes that you have to take in order to become certified in order to do what we do. Because there's a lot of math, which is not my favorite subject. There's a lot of math with this.
Uh-huh.
And it really is a 4 or 5 year learning curve on being able to design to get electricity and now broadband into people's homes.
Great.
And that's one of the other things in the American Jobs Plan and things we're working on right now in Congress is trying to do the kind of workforce training programs that really help people who want to do this work figure out how they can get the training and credentials to do it. And maybe some people want to change jobs, but we also know we're going to need people for the foreseeable future to really make sure that we can get this done. And that's part of the jobs creation piece of it. But there's really strong bipartisan interest in figuring out how we help people decide what they want to do after high school and throughout their careers and get the training in a way that makes sense for them. So that's another piece of it that's going to be really exciting.
Thank you all very much. Thank you for all the work you're doing. Thank you. This is really great.
Appreciate
really glad to be able to see it firsthand. And with this beautiful backdrop, right?
The sun just came out.
Thank you, guys. Okay.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you all.
Thanks, Senator.
Thank you for talking me off the ledge.
You are so good. You are so good. You're so good.
Public speaking is not my strong point,
ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Whenever you have to talk, just remember, you know something other people know. It's not going to stand up.
Thank you.
Thank you. So very accurate. Thank you.